Worship this morning, I offer you these words written by William Ellery Channing nearly 200 years ago. Let us come to this place of worship with the soul to elevate the spirit of the Most High. Let not this house be desecrated by a religion of show. Let it not degenerate into a place of forms. Let not your pews be occupied by lifeless machines. Do not come here to take part in lethargic repetitions of sacred words. Do not come from a cold sense of duty to quiet conscience. Do not come to perform a present task to ensure a future heaven. Rather, come to find heaven now, to anticipate the happiness of that better world by breathing its spirit, to bind our souls with our Maker. Let us come to worship with the heart as well as with the intellect, with life, fervor, zeal. Let us aspire for spiritual light and life. Let us come to cherish and express desires for virtue. Welcome, welcome joyfully every holy impulse, every accession of strength to virtuous purpose, to the life of the holy and to humanity. In a word, let us come to offer a refined and generous worship, to offer a tribute worthy of the Holy One, who is the perfection of truth, goodness, beauty, and blessedness. Come, let us worship. You might think I brought this to play it. That's not going to happen today. But this is, who can tell me what kind of instrument this is? What kind of a musical instrument is this? Yes? It's a banjo. Did you know that the banjo is the only uniquely American instrument of all the instruments throughout the world? The banjo is unique. And some will have five strings, some will have four, some will have a hollow back, other ones will have a solid back. And the person that we're talking about right now is a man by the name of Pete Seeger. And Pete Seeger liked to play the banjo. And he wrote a number of songs, some like Where Have All the Flowers Gone, I first heard when I was 9 years old. And I was at a camp, and we learned how to sing it. And even then, when we sang it, I knew it was kind of a sad song. What I have learned in the years since then is that Pete Seeger wrote a lot of protest songs. What do you think a protest song might protest, object to? And am I gonna write a protest song about people being happy? About the sun? About summer vacation? No, you're gonna write protest songs like he did about things like war and injustice. And in fact, Pete Seeger, later in life, became a Unitarian Universalist. And some of the songs are written out for you on the sheet that I just gave you. Now, one of the pictures on there is of Pete singing, and the other one is a picture, a close-up view of his banjo. And can someone read for me what it says on the banjo? Talia?
This machine surrounds hate and forces it to surrender.
Outstanding. This machine surrounds hate and forces it to surrender. Now, he got the idea to write on his banjo from a man by the name of Woody Guthrie. Now, Woody Guthrie had a guitar and also sang protest song. But he wrote on his guitar, "This machine kills fascists." And he didn't mean he was going to take it and hit people. He meant that the songs would move people to take a stand against evil people. But Pete Seeger thought, well, that's kind of gory. We don't want to kill people, but we want them to surrender, to give up the hatred that they have as part of their life. So, believe it or not, not everyone wanted to hear that message. There were some people who made a lot of money from war and from injustice back then and even today. And so the people in power in the government, both here in the United States and also in other parts of the world, tried to silence him. They tried to ban his music because they thought if he can't sing, people won't listen and people won't change and stand up against bad people and bad ideas. And one very famous example happened in Barcelona. Barcelona is a city in Spain. Beautiful, beautiful city. But back around 1970, Spain was ruled by an awful man by the name of Francisco Franco. And he was a fascist and he was a killer. And he survived World War II, but he was still a very awful human being. But Pete Seeger got permission to do a concert. And then the government in Spain panicked, and they said, well, you can do the concert, but you can't sing. Can you imagine doing a concert and not singing? And so he got up on stage with his banjo, and he had a piece of paper from the government of Spain. And he said, this piece of paper says I'm not allowed to sing to you. And the crowd was like, oh no, because they had come to hear him sing. But then he said, you know, I read this paper, and it doesn't say anything about you not singing if I just play the music. What do you think about that? Pretty clever. And to give you an idea of what that might sound like, I've asked Bonnie to play the first chord, or the first part of Where Have All the Flowers Gone? And imagine that everyone here is part of that concert, and so I'm going to pretend that I'm strumming my banjo, and you're going to sing the first refrain. It just goes to show that throughout time, even in our own times, there are people who are going to try to silence people who want to say and sing good things and want to challenge authority. And so when that happens, sometimes we have to be very creative and let those kind of people know that there's all these kind of people who will stand up to them. So I thank you for listening. And weeks ago, I spoke at UIS to a classroom of college freshmen. The topic was communication, and I was invited by the professor to discuss the various ways that I, as a person of faith, use communication amongst my congregation, amongst readership within the city of Springfield, and between colleagues. And so I discussed things like how something as simple as a stole communicates a certain idea. And I brought several examples, some of which were very proudly emblazoned with LGBT colors. I shared some of my articles. I shared some of my letters to the editor. I did not burden them with any of my sermons. They have to come here for that. But then I talked about how communication has changed and how certain forms of communication that I might favor, such as, say, Facebook, which was once quite novel, are rather limited by generational use, and other things like tweeting is how a younger generation currently might communicate with each other, that or Instagram. And that those who are removed from those streams of communication are severed because we cannot impart whatever wisdom we would hope to do so between these different generations. Now, we have just read a small sampling of what William Ellery Channing offered to the world, a rather lengthy responsive reading. Some of the language has been tweaked. He did not use the word humankind. He would have said mankind, perhaps. But you will note that he did not parse his words. A typical sermon back in his day would have lasted an hour and a half to 2 hours. And on this day, on this occasion, May the 5th, 1819, at the ordination of a junior colleague, William Ellery Channing climbed up into the pulpit of the Baltimore Unitarian Church, and he delivered a 2-hour manifesto delineating for all to hear and later for all to read what were the groundbreaking principles of American Unitarianism. This particular sermon, sometimes called Unitarian Christianity or the Baltimore Sermon, shattered records as far as being reprinted and sold. It was a bestseller, if you can imagine a sermon being a bestseller. And what he did in that particular sermon was to say, prove all things and hold fast that which is true, which is taken from Scripture, and he used it as his foundational text and the foundation of the Unitarian movement. Prove something, demonstrate it. Don't just accept it because somebody else told you, but prove it and make it your own. And using that slender slice of Scripture, he then said, Unitarians, we will accept that term, Unitarians read Scripture differently than our more conservative brothers and sisters. He said, when we read Scripture, we understand that it is a revelation, but that God has charged us to use our reasoning faculties, and that God is not a deceptor. He does not trick us with our reason, but he puts things so that we can wrestle with it. We can understand what is being said. We can compare it with other scriptures throughout the text, and we can choose to believe what we feel is true, what speaks to our own conscience. He said, if the Bible were written in a distinct language where the words were unique only to that one document, it would be worthless because you could not think about it. You would just accept and recite. But because it is written in the common tongue, and of course the common tongues throughout history, it uses metaphor, it uses all these tools, allusions, and it teases the mind to break through just a black and white copy on the printed page to make sense out of what our forebears wrote when they were inspired. He said, the Bible is a book written by human beings for human beings. They may have been inspired, but they were all these words and all these sentiments were channeled through individual human beings, and in fact, a Bible is a library. Some of the books which are much more favored by certain denominations, others which are rejected. And that is very true. We've often heard the term cherry-picking scriptures to serve a purpose, and he said that is one of the great constants throughout all of human history, that people of faith will cherry-pick certain things to bolster what they already believed going into a discussion. And he said, this is what everyone does, and in fact, we find that some elements of Scripture speak more favorably about the essence of God and about the essence of humanity. He said, for example, we believe that God is like a parent, the parental nature of God. And he said, the classic quality of a human parent is love, and that we cannot divorce our real experience of what it means to be loved from the attributes we would assign to a deity, and that the standards of justice and love and mercy that we would ascribe to a parent hold true even to this divine being. And if anything is done out of hatred or malice, it cannot be ascribed to God. It must come from another source. Human pettiness, for example, evil. But if it comes from God, he said, it must be grounded in love. And that was quite remarkable to say in 1819, when Calvinism, both abroad and here in these United States, was very firmly entrenched. When there was a prevailing notion that most humanity had been created just to serve an eternal sentence in hell, and there was nothing that people could do about it. And he turned that argument on its head and said, actually, if we believe that God is the source of love and that God is honorable and just, his plan must be somehow to redeem human beings, to get them to see the folly of their ways, and to turn them towards good. Not just good thoughts and good beliefs, but good actions. He went further in another sermon, which is entitled Likeness to God, and he said, it is written in Genesis that we are created, we are fashioned in the likeness of God, of the Creator. And in the common imagination, that means that human beings must look like God, must have a head, a neck, shoulders, so forth and so on, and that God is like a magnified, extraordinary human being writ large across the universe. And he said, that's ridiculous. That is just us projecting our human prejudices on the divine. What is unique about God, he said, is that God has an ethical nature, and that insofar as we act as ethical human beings and strive for goodness, strive for truth and justice, that is how we approach the likeness of God, and that our own conscience will tell us whether or not we are succeeding. Not unlike what Abraham Lincoln said, when I do good, I feel good. When I do bad, I feel bad. That is the sum of his religion, Lincoln said. And that germ of an idea is to be found in Channing. It is in doing good that we approach this ideal of goodness or God and grace. When we are evil to each other or to ourselves, we are turning our faces from the goodness of God and from the ethical nature. And he said, this new religion, this Unitarian Christianity, this Unitarian movement is going to lift up that notion that we are called to service. It's not just about shutting ourselves in our libraries and ivory towers, but being out in the world and practicing what we preach. He said, it's a good thing to be educated, because the more you know, the more you can wrestle with all the intricacies of Scripture. But it is better to be a human being in service to the world. Salvation by character. Now, Mr. Channing did believe in an afterlife. He did believe in a heaven. He did believe that there was a God who had created an individual named Jesus, but that the two were completely distinct. And he lays out the argumentation why the Jews of old and the early Christians could never have understood that Jesus was one with God, based on textual analysis and common sense. He said, for example, the word Trinity never appears in Scripture. Why is that? And where did the notion of a Trinity come from? He said, where does Jesus ever declare, according to the gospel narratives, that this I say as a human being and this I say as God? Who was it who died on the cross? And he looks at the classic Christian understandings of a need for death to blot out all sins, and he examines it and lays it out in the context of this one sermon and says, this is ridiculous if you actually look at it. But he said, Jesus did exist. And the power of Jesus and in his ministry was in his example. That he was a human being just like us who lived, breathed, and ultimately died, but was used by God for a particular purpose so that human beings could understand the folly of their sins and turn their devotions and hearts and worship to God. This was a powerful tonic to a nation that was in the grips of Calvinism, which harked back to that sermon by Jonathan Edwards that we are all sinners in the hands of an angry God who holds us as if we were a loathsome spider over a burning cauldron. And for many people in these United States 200 years ago, that was the prevailing wisdom about what Christianity offered. You must believe in everything that the church had taught you. You must not question, you must not dispute, but you must accept the wisdom of the elders and pass it on to the next generation. Channing said, that's not the purpose of an education. We are not to chain the rising generation and futures with our own prejudices and our own understandings, but we are to free the mind, to liberate them so that they can understand and reason with Scripture and look at life through their own eyes and come to understand their purpose in this universe as well as that of the Holy Spirit. His idea of religion included another dimension, which is well worth speaking. He said, in this world, there are some systemic evils. Slavery is one. There are slave powers who have enchained the imagination and keep millions of people in bondage. And we feel that we cannot break free. And he said, slavery is an evil, and we must do something about it. We must not keep quiet. We must work to break those chains, the chains of the mind and the chains on the human body. This was pretty radical stuff for a New England preacher many of whose parishioners may have profited off the slave trade a generation or two before. But he held them accountable for the existing systems that plagued their society. And he said, it's not enough to just say we didn't do it ourselves, but we have inherited all the profits of the past of this evil system, and we must use that profit and our privilege to address these evils. He also said that there are individuals of late, such as Napoleon, who some people imagine a great human being because of his propaganda machine. But if you actually look at the destruction wrought by that individual and all of the people who supported his endeavors, you will see that Europe stinks with the stench of the dead. And all these broken families, all these broken civilizations, and that it was all for the flight of his fancy. And he said, do not follow people like that. There will always be people like that who will get you to follow the flag, who will lift up this aspiration that we are doing holy work while we are killing other people. Don't believe it, he said. It's the work of evil, and we must be smart enough to recognize that and to stand strong against them. He also said, and there's a hint of this in the reading, that in our understanding of what is holy and what is not, there are going to be some people who believe things that we are uncomfortable with. In his own day, there were people who believed that Jesus was a human being, nothing more, but nothing less. There were others who believed that Jesus was a special being created by God to usher in a plan of salvation. He said, in this Unitarian movement, we welcome people, even if we personally disagree with what they happen to believe theologically. And that was a groundbreaking idea, that you could have diverse religious beliefs in one movement, and that people would agree to disagree and agree to learn from each other rather than to say, you must be removed. Now, sadly, when he gave this sermon, there had been a great schism in the Christian movement in New England. Planted by the Puritans, the congregational movement had become very successful up and down the New England seaboard. But over the course of several centuries, there had been a division between the liberal Christians, later the Unitarians, and the conservative Christians, later the United Church of Christ. And at a certain point, the conservatives had said, we cannot abide your presence. We refuse to worship with you. We will not publish your sermons. We will not share a pulpit with you. You must be silenced. And so, regrettably, the movement tore itself apart. And Chan was one of those who tried desperately to get people to work together, to worship together. But like so many others throughout history, he failed. And a new movement was born. Sounds familiar. But he also understood that every congregation is first and foremost a temple of memory. A temple of memory of the best ideals as well as the aspirations of a community passed through the fire of thought and time. But it's also something that offers continuity between the generations that we forget at our peril. If we say that only the spokespeople of the present, the singers, the artists, the preachers, the people doing the work of the present matter, then we are at loss. And whatever tide comes along, we will be at the mercy of that tide. We must be planted in the mindsets and the works and wisdom of the past. Now, some of these words, as we have seen, can be rather lengthy. Some of the language is rather stilted. Some of the images are as unfamiliar to a lay person as perhaps the sonnets of Shakespeare. But if you know how to read, and if you are willing to spend and invest the time and do the work, you will see that he spoke to his generation, to the transcendentalists, who said, anywhere throughout the world that offers insight and inspiration to the world, we welcome. Whether it be Hindu, whether it be Buddhist, these were the new currents of thought in his day, and he said, we will be open to those currents. We will learn from people who are quite different from ourselves, and our own sense of spirituality will evolve and expand. And he understood that each generation that was going to follow was going to have new understandings and that they would continue to grow. And he coined a phrase, you will grow a soul. And he understood that every human being had the capacity to grow a soul. And that civilizations, countries, have a soul. And he was in a battle for the soul of his country at that time, just like we are in the battle for the soul of our country once again. He assumed that people were naturally curious and good, that people wanted to be educated, people wanted to learn, and that as new discoveries from science became available, that they would embrace these discoveries and include them in their religious understanding, that they would not turn their backs to science. He grew up in an age when they had not yet heard of dinosaurs. Darwin had not yet published. But he lived in an era when they had learned that electricity was not something sent by the gods to strike down evildoers, but was a natural phenomena, and that people could take and build lightning rods to deflect that energy. And he said, many forces of nature are like that. And the more we learn, the more we will learn to live in harmony with each other and with nature. And I suspect had he lived longer, he would have embraced the notions of evolution and many other things, which even today, so many of our fellows turn their back on. He could not have envisioned a United States of 2019 where 40% of its citizens reject the notion of evolution, reject the thought that the world and the universe might be billions of years old, where many cling to a notion that the Earth was created approximately 6,000 years ago. He would have been horrified that this age, 200 years hence from his sermon, would have turned its back on learning and education, and that Unitarians would have abandoned the fight against what passes as orthodoxy or pietism so that false preachers can preach about prosperity gospels and other things and shutter people's minds. He would have said, the calling of this denomination, this Unitarian Christianity or this Unitarian movement, is to constantly engage with the culture and with preachers of diverse denominations who try to shut down the mind, who try to reduce the understanding of Scripture to just a few stray lines, to engage with them, to fight with them, so that the great mass of people would have access to a wealth of information and a greater understanding, not only about what is in Scripture, but about human nature and the essence of the Holy One. And I think that to answer the question, does Channing matter? I have to say yes. Many of us in this room are only fleetingly familiar with what he wrote, let alone his life. I could go on and tell you some particulars about him, but that's for another day. But I'm led to him to believe that the future of spirituality is rooted in the here and now. Listening to the echoes of the past, listening to the memories of the past, creating a template that we can pass on to future generations so that we may write and sing and preach and work so that others will take up the work with us. I'll let you get that. That's the same song that Celeste assigned to us, Celeste. But let us always remember, first and foremost, this is a living tradition. And in this building, we have a room named after Channing. But it's not enough just to put a plaque and to pay fleeting tribute to the past. It is worthy of us and the future to come to grips with the past, to come to grips with the future, so that the future might be worthy of those who have yet to follow. Amen and blessed be. For our closing words, I turn to Sarah Moores Campbell, a colleague of mine. Give us the spirit of a child. Give us the spirit of the child. Give us the child who lives within, the child who trusts, the child who imagines, the child who sings, the child who receives without reservation, the child who gives without judgment. Give us a child's eyes that we may receive the beauty and freshness of the day, like a sunrise. Give us a child's ears that we may hear the music of mythical times. Give us a child's heart that we may be filled with wonder and delight. Give us a child's faith that we may be cured of our cynicism. And finally, give us the spirit of the child who is not afraid to need, who is not afraid to love. Amen.